and what God really desires for us in this life here. And so we're going to talk about God and chaos and how these things do not mix. In Mark chapter 4, verse 37, and it says, "And there arose a great storm of wind, and the waves beat into the ship, so that it was now full." In other words, they had a vessel full of water. And how many of you know when water gets in a vessel, it gets full, it is subject to sink. "And he was in the hinder part of the ship, asleep on a pillow." It's talking about Jesus. "And they awake him and say unto him, Master, carest thou not that we perish?" In other words, now Jesus is in the boat. He's not just in the boat, but he's down inside under, and he's got his pillow out, and he's all laid out, stretched out, and he's sleeping. Now, I know that chances are he's probably feeling the waves. You kind of feel in the unrest. But yet none of those things causes him to wake up. He is resting. He's in peace. And yet his disciples, who's on the ship with him, who is kind of like viewing the environment and seeing the circumstances. And as they surmise from the circumstance, all they can see is that we ain't going to make it, right? So they want to wake Jesus up now because they think he's not aware of this dilemma. They're thinking that he's not aware of how close they are to perishing. So they wake him up. "And he arose and he rebuked the wind and said unto the sea, Peace, be still. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm." A great calm. "And he said unto them, Why are you so fearful?" Question he asked many times, "Why are you afraid? Why are you fearful? Be not afraid. Fear not." Over and over, he keeps saying those little words like, "Don't be afraid. Just believe. Don't fear." And so here, he asks them, "Why are you so fearful?" And then he go ahead from there and said, "Now, where is your faith?" I mean, what part of this are you really believing? What are you believing in? You afraid? Why are you afraid? And if you are afraid, the question is, where is your faith? Because it's quite possible for me to have more faith in the storm than have faith in Jesus. I don't think they were there on that boat because they lacked faith in Jesus. I think they believed him because they got on board with him. But there are times when storms arise that causes us to become afraid because we begin to believe in them more than we believe in him. That's why the Bible says we don't walk by sight. The just shall live by faith. And so he said, "And they feared exceedingly after they seen the miracle." This is what really got me. Their fear didn't get lessened by what they saw. After they seen what he could do, it got even worse for them. Then they really became fearful because here's a man laying down in the boat, not caring whether they perish. And then he gets up very calmly and speaks to the storm, speaks to the wind, speaks to the sea, tell it to peace, be still, and it stops. Becomes a great calm. So I think tonight we want to look at chaos because sometimes chaos is what creates so much fear. And it's hard to operate in chaos. I've made it a point in my life is that if I have to make any type of decision, I never make it in the midst of chaos. I never make any type of decision in the midst of a storm. You know, I can't make it till I find a place of peace because it's from that place there that I have power to change whatever the storm is. So when I think of storms, when I think of this, I know we have a word we call chaos. I'm sure if you've never heard that word, it is a word greatly used. You know, he's very chaotic. Man, I'm living in chaos. Even people today in this world, even Christian people today in their life, they can say, I'm living in chaos. And today I want to help us realize not to accept chaos in our life. I can't tell you chaos won't come, but it will. But we don't have to accept chaos. We got to figure out how to deal with all the chaoticness of our life. You know, when we got confusion, frustration, all this stuff is called chaos. When you got all kind of stress, pressure, uncertainties, all this happened to us, and we try to work out of it, it makes us sick, it drains us of energy, it gives us headaches. I mean, it just literally takes all the life out of living. When you're living in chaos, you can't never have enough energy to deal with it. And most people will end up, if they're not careful, committing suicide because of all the chaos. I know we haven't got there, but I would ask, you know, you, because it's one thing I find about human beings, though. We adapt or adjust to things. We don't even remember when we first stopped being healthy. Do you know that? You know why? The first day that we didn't feel good, we adapted to that day that we didn't feel good, and then we made that the norm. Because usually what happened is that nobody gets sick in one day. But what we do is make adjustments, adapt. Just like if you had a sore toe. You know what you do? If you don't want to get it fixed, you just adapt to it. You just kind of like, don't put no weight on it. And they say, no, you're walking like this. Because you won't put weight on that toe. And you may start walking like that for the rest of your life. Because now you have adapted to something that's abnormal. So it's very easy for us to really get adjusted and adapt to living in a whole lot of chaos and a whole lot of craziness and keep adjusting to it. It's like the wife that goes home and her husband beats her up. And many people say, well, why would she stay in that abuse situation, right? Man, she's crazy. Well, no, what happened? The first time she got hit, it surprised her. The next time she adapts, she looks for it. Yeah. Because now, not only do we adapt that way, but we have to readjust even our thinking. And somehow, in the middle of that, you know, I've seen a lot of crazy situations in my life where even in a situation like abuse, that the woman would think that it was love because she had readjusted her sights on normal relationship and will equate a whooping with love. But anyway, we're not going to use psychology class tonight. I just throw that out there. It'll cost you nothing. So what I want us to do, first of all, is we need, you know, the thing about all of these teachings and everything we've done is that you must begin to look at yourself. You don't need to look at anybody else. Just have to know for yourself. You got to know these things for you. You got to look inside your own self and, you know, quit trying to adjust for what is not right in you. You know, just, hey, if it's me, it's me. Simple. If I got chaos, it's me. You know, I ain't blaming nobody else for that because only thing can come in my life is what I allow in my life. Now, if I allow it in my life, then I should not complain about what it's doing. All right? Because I allow that. But now anything to try to bust the doors in and get in, now I can stand and fight against that. But it's hard to fight against things that you have allowed inside. It's hard to get those things under control. Now, I'm sure and certain that as we sit here tonight, if you know, we can remember, have there ever been a time in your life when you felt like your life was out of control? That you couldn't get a handle on it? And one of the most frustrating things about life is when life gets out of control. And no matter what you try to do, it never gets better. In your mind, you're saying, I want it better, but your life, you can't control it. It gets worse. Now, maybe you haven't experienced that, but I have. You know, my life completely gone, out of control. Can't bring it in subjection. Can't get it where I want it. Know where it needs to be, but I can't get it there. That's called chaos, you know, and many even not into a great extreme sometimes. You know, it's just like a lot of people get angry with themselves. Let's say the most common thing today is that, okay, I'm overweight. They get frustrated. It ain't nothing like going on a diet of lettuce for 2 weeks and then get on the scales and all you lost was a pound. Ain't nothing like going 4 weeks and you said they lost but two. And you're doing everything you can. And then finally you just give up. What's the use? I'm just going to go ahead and be miserable. Because you're fighting the idea that I feel like I'm too big. And then when you go to try to correct because you are, now you're frustrated because the harder you try, you know, once you get this stuff on, it's hard to get it off. A little sugar, sugar on the lips. But it's hard to get it off once it gets off. So we become very frustrated. Life becomes chaotic. People go through all kinds of changes when it comes to a lot of things that is out of control in our life. You know, one thing I like, I don't like diets. I don't believe in them. You know why I don't like them? Because I'm really starving myself from stuff that I like. So what I need to learn how to do is control what? There you go. It's not what you eat. It's the amount you eat. I still love pies. Just don't eat as whole ones no more. So how many times when you look in your life, you'd rather be, you wish that somehow you was more organized. That's me. That's me then. I wish I was organized. I wish I could get up every morning with a day timer. I wish I could get up every day and have me a real good routine. But I don't have, and every time I think about just, man, I just want to organize my life where that, you know, point B, point A, point C. I get frustrated sometimes about that. And then we look at all these experiences because, like I said, after a while, you learn how to adjust to chaos. People learn how to live in hell. They learn how to do it every day. And see, I don't want to get in chaos and get satisfied. Not when God has promised me peace. I refuse to live any less than what God has proclaimed for me to live. And so when I see chaos, then I need to see what chaos really is. Again, I'm not talking about the world itself. It's what I let in here is what I'm talking about. I got to make sure that I'm not allowing chaos to foment in my life. I got to make sure that I'm living in a place of peace and not in a whole bunch of chaos. And if I ask you the question, do you enjoy living with migraine headaches and pressure in the head? Do you enjoy that? Do you enjoy getting up every day feeling frustrated? Do you enjoy that? Now, I don't know of anybody that gets up in the morning and raises a hand to God and say, God, send me through hell today. I don't know of anybody. So I ask you that because I know it's a rhetorical question because I know there's nobody that really wants to get up every day and go through all the stress and pressure of life every day of your life. All you've ever done from the time you got up to the time you laid down and then you wake up the next day chewing on the same junk you laid down on last night. And now it's went from weeks now to months, and from months now to years. Chaos is like a bad disease. Because the more it's in your life, the more it creates. It doesn't stop with one thing. Today, it's just a financial problem. The next day, it's a health problem. And the next thing you know, it's more problems created from just one problem. Because they all seem to be fruitful in the wrong way. So when you look ahead and you look at yourself, you have to tell yourself, you know what, I'm making up my mind. We got to come to a place in our life where we got to make up our mind. We're not going to live another year in chaos. I'm going to face my chaos. I'm going to look at my chaos in the eye. I'm going to tell my chaos this is the last day that me and you are going to be hanging out together. Because I'm not going to live in chaos anymore, especially when I know Jesus has told me he gave me peace. Now, we get into the Word of God and realize one thing about God, because God is not, chaos is not new to God. It's not new. He's been dealing with chaos before. I think we can learn some things from the way he dealt with chaos, because when I see what he done with it before, now I can know what he can do it for me in this chaos. Now we see in the book of Genesis chapter 1, matter of fact, in his creation that he began to, in Genesis said, in the beginning God created heaven and earth, and went on to talk about how the earth was void and without form, and if you looked it up, it means that it was kind of chaotic. It means that somehow or another, after Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, the second verse is that somehow something happened, and I'm not here to speculate about what went on, but it seemed like something fell out of place, something got out of order, and then the Bible said, and when it did, then God's Spirit began to move. And God's Spirit moved upon the face of chaos. And it's from his moving on the face of chaos that he then began to recreate what I call peace. He took what was messed up and then he began to recreate until finally he says at last, and what he had created, it is good. The same thing in our life. If it's chaos, that means that God wants to be present to move, to recreate, to put things in order. So that at the end of that, he can say, and it was good. So we see in the book of Genesis how that God began to move upon that chaotic situation. Because I believe that's not one situation in our lives that God is not concerned about. I don't believe God wants you to have a nervous breakdown. I don't. Anytime that I'm borderline in there, it means that somehow or another, I need to get a handle on something. There should be nothing in this world that could drive you crazy. You know how I know that? Because Jesus came into this same world, and there was nothing in it that could drive him crazy. And as he was, so are we. Do you think he did not see, have some of the same issues that we had as far as, you know, even his own brother, they tell me, didn't even accept him, thought he was crazy. Even the people around him thought he was crazy. Matter of fact, he's in that teaching one time, and people came to his mother and said, boy, he's a goner. He ain't working with all steps. His elevator ain't going to the top. But yet somehow, he had peace in everything he done. He had peace when they were trying to throw stones at him. He had peace. When they tried to throw him over the cliff, he had peace. when they rejected him. Now that's a whole nother word, ain't it? Man, somebody rejected us, guess what? We in turmoil. How many times? We got all kind of psychological profiles now on, you know, rejection. First thing they ask you, do you feel like you've been rejected? Yeah. Is that why you killed them all? Yeah. We got psychological profiles. Y'all laughing, but I'm serious. Every time somebody do something, they have these psychological profiles. And especially, see, I understand. I said, I can understand the people that don't know Jesus. I can understand all that. So these words wouldn't be for them. But these words are for us who said we know him. All right? And then we're still in chaos in our life over something that happened in childhood. Something that happened 10 years ago. Can't get away from it. And all we've got from all that is this chaos that we try to deal with on a day-to-day basis. That's what I'm telling you now. Forgiveness is the greatest thing ever happened to you. It is. Not only is the greatest thing that happened to you, but it's the greatest thing that happened to you when you learn how to do it too. Because without it, that's where chaos comes. If I'm going to carry you around in my heart, I want to make sure I love you. I, you know, nothing worse than carrying your enemy around in your heart. Let me say that again. Oh, I ain't carrying him in my heart. Yes, you are. When you think about him, your world ends. You ever had that feeling? Everything you think about him, it's just like, I don't care how bright the sun was shining, you got to put your sunglasses on. Every time you think about it, because you can't stand the thought. Well, to me, that's like torment. I'm carrying something around I don't need to be carrying around. Why am I carrying you in my heart like that? Why do I have you in my life like that? See, I've always been one of those kind of guys. I live kind of light. When I have to move, I didn't need but a paper sack. I have a book of life. See, my book of life have pages. You know what happens if you get out of my book? I tear the page out. That way I don't have to read about you no more. But if I keep going back in my diary and I still got you in my pages, every time I read about you, I got to relive it. I told somebody, man, you got to learn, if you want to get rid of chaos in your life, you got to learn how to turn a page. Quit trying to write over the same stuff. Turn the page. Tear the page out of the book. Matter of fact, it's good. That's why Paul tells you, forgetting those things which are behind. Don't keep going back reading history. Today is time to make history. And you can't make history looking at the past like that. Well, praise God. So here we got God showing us. Because he's not happy when I'm in chaos. He knows he can't get my undivided attention if I'm living in hell. He knows that I'm just like those disciples on that boat. I know he's on the boat, but I'm very fearful. And the more chaos I got, less faith I have in him. Because most of the time when I got chaos in my life, I'm wondering what he's doing in the first place. Why are you allowing this chaos? Have you ever asked yourself that? God, I don't know why you take me through this. And sometimes it's not God taking us through that, because sometimes this is chaos we have allowed to get in there. And we'll blame God for taking us through. It's one thing if he told you to get on the boat. But it's another thing when you get your little John boat out, your own boat out. And you out to sea by yourself. I don't mind going through anything in this life as long as I know Jesus is at peace in my life. Can I say that again? As long as I know that Jesus is at peace in my life, I can go through anything. Well, here, praise God. See, here the thing is that when we read in Genesis and begin to see that he shows us something. He shows us something about his presence. See, from Genesis chapter 1 and chapter 3, talking about what happens after his spirit move and put things in order and all the peace, and then we get in chapter 3, and all of a sudden man fails, and all of a sudden now man is cast from the presence of God. See, that's one of the things that I was in here just thinking this evening, is that we got to learn our peace is in his presence. Okay? It's in his presence. And the farther away you get, notice Genesis in chapter 3, the farther away, when he put them out, the farther they walked away from his presence, the more chaos came into the world. The Bible said they went eastward. As they went out eastward, the farther away, the worse they got. The farther away, until finally, God says, it's too much chaos. I'm gonna have to change some stuff. I might start this all over. I gotta start this all over like I started in the beginning. I gotta start it off with peace. You know how I know that? Because it started out with Noah. You know what Noah's name means? Peace. He was trying to give you a message. When I start you over, I'm not going to start you over in chaos. I'm going to start you out in peace. A new beginning is a peace beginning. And if you don't get peace in the beginning, that's why it's hard to find in the end. I must become acquainted with his peace. And so when they finally had to destroy the earth, then another example, I was sitting there just thinking tonight, show me about Martha and Mary. Remember the Bible said she was coming about, she was troubled. She was troubled about many things. And guess where she were? She wasn't where she should have been. Here she were in here, cumbered, troubled about a lot of stuff. And here's Mary. I'm sure Mary had problems. Matter of fact, her name means problems. Her name really means rebellion. But she had enough sense to know is that I need to bring my chaos to where chaos can be fixed. See, a lot of times in this, we think if I get busy, I can get past my chaos, but your busyness only creates more chaos. The only place that you can get rid, bring your rebellion into the presence of God. And then Jesus said to Martha, you know, Mary has chosen the better part. She's going to sit here and let these words get down in her spirit. You're troubled, but she's getting a word. She's got problems, but she's getting a word. And see, our problem is a lot of times we spend too much time trying to fix a problem when we need to just get in a position where that God will fix it for you. And the place I need to be and you need to be is in his presence. Praise God. Then we look over in Egypt when in Israel all over here is a slave. And Let's read that together in Exodus chapter 1, verse 8, where it says, "Now there arose up a new king over Egypt, which knew not Joseph." You know, we like children of Israel over here in America. Every 4 years we have to get a new king and we get troubled. There's more families fighting right now about politics than you ever seen in your life. We're troubled. We're trying to figure out who's gonna be the best one, because we're troubled. And I know, don't get me wrong, I'm not putting my head in sand, act like ain't nothing going on. It is going on. A lot of stuff is happening. But you know where I'm finding my consolation at? God got everything under control. But if you don't believe that, then you out here trying to beat the bandwagon and trying to, you know, I don't mind stating my opinion. If you ask me, I'm going to tell you what I feel, you know. But that's not my piece. I don't really care which one get in. I do care, but I don't care. Because at the end of the day, I'm still going to be just where I was when they got in. That position out there ain't going to change my position in him. All right, so I'm not going to allow whichever one. I'm going to salute them. Go ahead on. I'm pray for them. But as far as me getting bent out of shape on who's going to run the White House, no, I know a house bigger than the White House. So I'm not concerned. My concern is, Lord, in the midst of all this chaos, in the midst of all this craziness, Lord, let me sit at your feet and let your words drop down in my spirit so that I can maintain this peace you gave me. You know, if I'm looking at this world naturally, I'm telling you right now, we are in a great big mess. All right? And I'll say something else. I don't even think it's going to get better. But what I'm telling you will get better for you. Yeah. I can tell you what will get better, though, for us. It's him. It's something about when times are hard, God is better. There's something about when things is chaotic, his peace feels better. You cannot even begin to appreciate the peace of God without a storm. I don't know of anything that's more rewarding to me than to have a storm and then have peace in the midst of it that drives me crazy. Can't figure out why I'm not pulling the hair out of my head. I know I shaved it, but before then. Why am I not going crazy? But the peace of God sustains us. Oh, hallelujah. So here they were, a new king. He rises up. You know, that's always a problem. Don't you think that, see that? Every time somebody get in, there's always a problem. New king, new problems. Every time one come out, he said he's going to fix the last problem that guy had, and he comes in and creates some more problems, even worse than the last guy, and they just keep perpetuating problems. And somehow Christian people, let me tell you something, let's quit looking to people to be our deliverer. God never set up any man to be your deliverer. He is your savior. He is your deliverer. And matter of fact, that's why I think things will have to get worse so the Christian people can finally realize who their Savior is. We got to come to a place where we really believe that Jesus Christ is our Savior. And he saves, he delivers, he heals, he prospers, he keeps us. He's our safety, he's our shield, buckler, he's our captain, he's everything. The Bible goes on to say, he said unto the people, behold, the people of children of Israel are more and mightier than we. This is the Egyptian king. Now he, you know, it was good there for a while, but now he's finding out some things that now they're outnumbered, outgunned, and everything else. And now the free labor is not worth the free labor's time now to do something different. And if they begin to sit down and weigh it up, says, you know, if we go to war, and somehow they're not on our side, and then you know what's going to happen then? They're going to turn against us, man, and we're going to have to fight on all fronts. And so, you know, the best thing to do is we got to cut down on the population. We got to do something about the birth rate. There's way too many people. We're going to have to take care of that. And so they, what they done, they instituted those Egyptian midwives, and they had, of course, Hebrew midwives. DMH was not invented then. The OB ward. It was a home deal. And so here you had the midwives of the Egyptians. They came up with a plan. Said, man, I tell you what we do. Every time y'all go over help them Jewish women have their babies, them Hebrew women, he said, now, if it's a boy, kill him. If it's a girl, let it ride. And what happened is that God, see, when God is for you, he'll outsmart the world. See, he already knows what they're up to before they get up to it. And what happened is that every time one of them Hebrew women who was having a boy baby, get ready to have a boy baby, she went in labor 10 seconds. While the midwives in there trying to get the water ready, she hadn't had the baby. And they went back, and the Egyptian king said, what's wrong? He said, well, you know, them Hebrew women, they don't have babies like Egyptian. Said, hey, they had them live babies. They come out live. They come out alive. I mean, they come out quicker than I ever seen anything come out. See, God knows how to work miracles when there is makes no sense. But nobody's going to outdo God. And they went back and told him that, so they realized now, well, if we can't kill him, we got to figure out some things that we can do. And then I was reading a little bit farther over in that where it says, and the Lord prophesied, said, you know, I'm going to make Pharaoh, he's going to drive him out with a strong hand. I got to think about that. There are times when God empowers our enemy to help us move to our next place. Huh? Would never make it. Now here he empowered Pharaoh with a strong hand that was stronger than the Israelites to drive them out of Egypt. Man, if I was being prophetic right now, I'll tell you right now, I see a strong hand coming here too. Gonna drive us out of Egypt. Because we can't come out by ourselves. We have just kept adjusting. The world made it harder for us to live, and we just kept adjusting. They used to bring us our cement and sand, but now they tell us we got to go get it and then make the same wages. Huh? And then that wasn't good enough because they said you had too much time. You're going to church and you're trying to worship God. You got too much time in your hand. You know what? We need you go get your straw too. Isn't it strange the moment that you decide that you're going to really serve God, seem like the devil gets busy and want to put more stuff on you to give you more excuses why you can't serve God? Huh? And so, sure enough, you done went out early in the morning, you done got your own sand, got your own cement mix, and been stomping on hay and stuff and making mortar and brick all day long. Yes, you done spent 12-hour days in a job. Do you think you're going to feel like lifting your hands at night? Probably not. But what happens to a person who has this blessing in their life, you can't be happy now because this is really frustrating. It's driving me crazy if they call me in on my church day, which I usually didn't go no way if they did. So, I mean, that's just me. I did. It would upset me. But here the king of Egypt, Pharaoh, has created a strong hand against the people of God. But God's going to show Pharaoh that his hand is stronger than the Pharaoh's hand. Who needs the convincing? God or us? Because sometimes I think we think maybe God doesn't have as much power as he thinks. Look how bad, how many times have I heard it? Look how bad the world is. Yeah, but look how big God is. You know what? You know what I get excited about is that, yeah, the world is bad, but God is bigger than the world. And if he can put up with it, then I know. Mm-mm. We only see a little small part where we live. We ain't even seeing half of the world. We see our little neighborhood. We may not even, you know, I was in Chicago. People live in Chicago, ain't never been outside of Chicago.